day is a promise of your love for us and our love for you. The rain and wind have been very strong this week, and they are yours, of your creation, and a reminder that we are not in control, you are. Keep us ever mindful of your gifts, dear Lord. Grace to you and peace of God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Will you join me in the call to worship taken from Psalm 146? I will praise the Lord all my life.
I will sing praise to my God as long as I live.
Do not put your trust in princes, in human beings who cannot save.
When their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing.
Blessed are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God.
He is the maker of heaven and earth, the sea, and everything in them. He remains faithful forever.
He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free. The Lord gives sight to the blind.
The Lord watches over the farmer and sustains the fatherless and the widow. When he frustrates the ways of wickedness,
the Lord reigns forever, for all generations. Praise the Lord. Let's sing to the Lord our praises with hymn 342. Rejoice, the Lord is King. Together. Holy God, who sent your Son into the world We admit that we are an imperfect people. We worry that we are somehow unforgivable or believe that we don't really need to confess our trivial sins. Or perhaps that we have not sinned at all. Lord, forgive us for shirking our responsibility and holding on to our fear or pride. Forgive us for judging others in ways that you yourself have not done. For seeing ourselves or others as unworthy of your redeeming grace. Help us to claim our new life with confidence and to live into the new people we are becoming, while also encouraging new life in others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Good morning.
Well, to turn to God with our prayer requests. Does anyone have any prayer requests? Okay, Arlene, let's lay you first.
Just continuing prayer for my brother-in-law, Max. He's going to be undergoing treatment for his cancer.
Max?
Yes.
Okay.
And his family who are going through this with him.
Okay, Chris?
Thank you, Lord, for the protection for Robert Dillon. He is at Rome, which was very near.
Oh, yeah. Anyone else?
Yes, my friend Nettie is going to rehab.
Nettie.
He's now strong enough.
Good. Dale?
Lincoln is breathing, is improving. Lincoln?
Lincoln?
Yeah, baby Lincoln.
Baby Lincoln.
Is he still in the ICU?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Eric?
Eric Monroe.
Oh, that's right, Eric Monroe, yeah.
I have from Wally.
From Wally. Yeah.
And for Cynthia Abar, the memorial service that's this week. And for all of our many neighbors who suffered damage due to the storm. I don't know if the rest of you can hear, but the sump pump keeps coming on in the basement. Thank God for sump pumps.
Yes.
It would have been that basement, the furnace would have been inundated if it was not for those sump pumps.
Okay. And I'll just add for all the kids returning to school. I don't know how many of our grandkids are going to school this week. I know Kiara and Zach start on the 7th, Kaylin starts on the 8th, and this will be Kaylin's first year in high school at the Morris Academy, is that right? Yeah. And little Charlie and Jess will be going to school in East Hanover. So, if there are no others, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that you hear all of our prayers and meet all of our needs, no matter how great, no matter how small. Lord, you are our salvation. This morning we come before you on our spiritual knees to give thanks to you for keeping us safe, for leading us beside the still waters and not in the flood waters, for restoring our souls. We give ourselves to you at this time, Lord, and we put our lives into your capable hands. We ask, Lord, that you would make us and mold us into vessels of honor that might glorify your kingdom. Make us your disciples, Lord. Grant us peace that passes all of our understanding, and give us eyes to see, ears to hear, hands to lend to each other, and feet to go where you would have us go. Help us to truly be your church in the world today. We pray for those among us who are sick and seek your comfort. For Eric Monroe, for Max, for continuing cancer treatment. We are thankful, Lord, for the protection of Robert as he was in danger from the floodwaters. We pray for Nettie, who is now in rehab, and for baby Lincoln, who remains in the ICU. We're thankful, Lord, for baby Lucy, who is home with her happy parents, Travis and Daniela. We're thankful for the gift of cell phones, where we can get weekly pictures of Lucy, even if we haven't seen her yet. We've seen pictures of her. We're also thankful for sump pumps that continue to do their job with a minimum of invasiveness on their part while we're worshiping. For Wally, our neighbor Wally, and for Cynthia Abar, as Arlene plans her mother's memorial service this week. For all of our friends and neighbors in Ridgefield and the surrounding towns, as they recover from the damage that Ida has caused. For all the kids who are returning to school this week, some for the first time, some going back to the same school. But we ask, Lord, that you would watch over them, keep them safe from the virus, keep them safe from all harm that could be caused in gathering in large groups. For all those facing illnesses and disease, suffering from the coronavirus, and the social and economic impact it's having on the world. For those people still in Afghanistan who are trying to get out but haven't been able to, we ask that you would provide a way. For all those traveling this weekend, as it's a holiday weekend, especially Claire, as she visits her family in Ohio. We ask all this, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
About their physical needs. What good is it In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds. Next Bible is Mark. Mark chapter 7, verses 24 through 37. Page number is 1564. Jesus left that place and went to the vicinity of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know it. Yet he could not keep his presence secret. In fact, as soon as she heard about him, a woman whose little daughter was possessed by an impure spirit came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek born in Syrian Phoenicia. She begged Jesus to drive the demon out of her daughter. First, let the children eat all they want. He told her, for it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Lord, she replied, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. Then he told her, for such a reply, you may go. The demon has left your daughter. She went home and found her child lying on the bed and the demon gone. And Jesus left the vicinity of Tyre and went through Sidon down to the Sea of Galilee and into the region of the Decapolis. There some people brought to him a man who was dead and could hardly talk. And they begged Jesus to place his hand on him. After he took him aside, away from the crowd, Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears. Then he spit and touched the man's tongue. He looked up to heaven and with a deep sigh said to him, Ephphatha, which means be opened. At this, the man's ears were opened, his tongue was loosened, and he began to speak plainly. Jesus commanded them not to tell anyone, but the more he did so, the more they kept talking about it. People were overwhelmed with amazement. He has done everything well, they said. He even makes the dead hear and the mute speak. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you so much, KJ. So before I begin my sermon for this Sunday, I want us to think back for a minute as to where we are here in our gospel story as it's recorded in Mark. It's always good for us to refresh our memory what's led us to today. Last Sunday, Jesus took the ritual cleansing laws and he turned them upside down. He said that it wasn't what went into a person that made them unclean, but rather what they held on to in their hearts that then came out of their mouths in angry words that made them unclean. And he directed that teaching toward the religious leaders of his day. Essentially, he was telling before the crowds who were gathered there watching that the Pharisees and scribes were the ones who were unclean. And then adding insult to injury, he also calls them hypocrites to their faces. It's not exactly a good way to make friends, now is it? But Jesus is unconcerned with making friends with the powerful. Jesus' only concern, in fact, is spreading the good news of God's kingdom to those whose hearts will receive it. To those Jews who have seen the signs and the miracles that he's been performing and believe they are a sign from God. And he's been going about in the region of Galilee, this Jewish territory, for quite some time now with his disciples. He's been healing, he's been preaching, he's been performing miracles in order to demonstrate to them the authority he's been given by God, and all of the teachings, the authority of the teachings that he is giving them as well. And now some of these teachings sound much different than the ones they've been told by the Jewish authorities. So in reframing what God wants for God's people, Jesus is also making himself into an enemy with the religious leaders. And so now, where KJ picked up our story this morning, it is time for Jesus and the disciples to move on. It's now time for them to leave these Jewish territories where the self-righteous scribes and Pharisees hold the reins of the religious power and elevate themselves above God's people and misrepresent God often for their own personal gain. It's time for Jesus to distance himself and his disciples from their watchful eyes and continual criticism of him and their growing ire toward him. So Jesus and his disciples now head off for Gentile territory. They go to Syrian Phoenicia, to a city named Tyre, which is located on the Mediterranean Sea. Jesus purposely heads off into a land considered unclean by Jews, a land where they will be surrounded by Gentiles. Gentiles, also known as Greeks in the New Testament, are despised by pious Jews. And for years, there's been a dual hatred between Gentiles and Jews. The Gentiles often made fun of the Jews and the many nitpicky, restrictive laws of cleanliness that they followed, which made them then a peculiar sect of people among a Greek culture. And in return, the Jews considered the Gentiles despicable and labeled them unclean. And they referred to them, in fact, in derogatory terms, calling them dogs. Jews refused to have anything whatsoever to do with Gentiles for fear of polluting themselves and becoming unclean. And to simply enter Gentile land automatically resulted in contamination. The dirt itself is believed to be polluted. So to walk in Gentile land created an unclean condition for which one must then wash and present oneself to the Jewish authorities along with a cleanliness sacrifice, of course, or suffer a state of ongoing uncleanliness and risk then their lives. We heard about that last week. To be unclean was to risk one's own life and blessings of God and to risk polluting others, one's family. Your uncleanliness could be passed off to your wife and your children. And so, as you can imagine, it would be unheard of to enter a Gentile home. It was unheard of to eat a meal with a Gentile.
And other than carrying out necessary business, Jews and Gentiles had little interaction with one another and even less regard for one another. And yet, it's for all these reasons that Gentile territory became the perfect place for Jesus and the disciples to escape to. This was the perfect place for them to go and retreat and get some rest from the crowds of Jews who had been following them everywhere. It's a perfect place to get away from the Jewish authorities who've been continually criticizing and persecuting them for what they were doing. After all, they wouldn't be caught dead in Gentile land. But beyond even all of that, entering Gentile land as a place of respite and rest for Jesus and the disciples is also a loud commentary to us about the many cleansing laws that pious Jews like the Pharisees and the scribes believed were important. Clearly, to Jesus, this didn't matter at all. So Jesus and the disciples head off for Tyre, a city well into Gentile land. In fact, it's all the way across to the Sea of, to the Mediterranean Sea. And there they enter a house in this Gentile city, and they plan to remain there quietly, undetected, in order to get some much-needed rest. After all, they, let's refresh our memories again, they've been on the go now for weeks. They've been traveling back and forth across the Sea of Galilee. They've fed thousands. They've been pursued by insatiable crowds and surrounded by throngs of people in need of healing with no end in sight and constantly criticized by the religious leaders. Even Jesus, human as he was in need of a break. But no sooner do they arrive at this house in Tyre, and word about their arrival begins to spread. It seems that the notoriety about this Jewish rabbi and the remarkable things he's been doing has reached far into Gentile territory. And it's not long at all until the first person arrives at the house demanding a healing. An unnamed woman falls down at Jesus' feet and begs. It seems her daughter has a demon. And Jesus' response is that he tries quickly to explain things to her and dismiss her. You see, they aren't here in Tyre for this. They haven't traveled all this way just to simply pick up where they left off in Galilee. And there's still so much work to be done among the Jews. He needs this rest in order to get back to work again and convince the Jews that their God was busy at work correcting their teachings and carrying out the ultimate act of redemption. And this good news that Jesus had come into the world to proclaim will come to the Gentiles in God's own good time. But that time is not now. Right now, Jesus and the disciples, they need to spend some time alone. Jesus needs time to teach his own disciples. They need time pray together. They need time to get some rest. That's why they've come here. But this woman, she will not be dissuaded. And in an incredibly bold act of faith, she persists in what she needs because she knows he can do it. Because of her faith in him. ability. She will not be denied. She's not about to take no for an answer here. This scene is a bold and dangerous act of faith carried out by a woman, by a stranger, by an unclean Gentile. She takes a tremendous risk in approaching him at all as a woman, and an even greater risk in not giving up her cause. She begs the bread of life for mere crumbs. She is convinced that mere crumbs is enough to heal her child, that the tiniest speck of mercy and love from Jesus will be enough to carry out the wholeness that she is seeking. And no sooner are these words from her heart spoken, a testimony of the deep faith she has in his ability, and Jesus has healed her daughter. She no longer has a demon. Her affliction is over. Jesus responds to the persistence of her faith with compassion, and he rewards her for it. My friends, this is a truly remarkable woman that we have in our scripture reading this morning. This is a woman who has a lot to teach us about being persistent when it comes to matters of our faith. She has much to teach us about demanding what we need in this world in order for us to be made whole. Too often we've spent too much time puzzling over Jesus' surprising and confusing response to her, and it is, I will admit that. But we often do that at the exception of looking at the tremendous depth of this woman's faith. This is a woman deemed unclean and unworthy by the religious. And as Gentiles ourselves, we have much to learn from her about her humility as she bows down at his feet, about her persistence as she refuses to take no for an answer, about her courage in seeking him out at all and then not being dissuaded, in her boldness to demand what it is she needs, and in her faith of what Jesus can do. This woman, an outcast, marginalized by Jewish society, asks for mere crumbs from Jesus because of her faith in what he can provide. While in contrast, the religious authorities back in Galilee only criticize him. And her confidence in Jesus results in receiving exactly what it is she's come looking for. Jesus has so much more to offer us than mere crumbs. He gives us the whole loaf of living bread to consume in order to strengthen our faith. Jesus is the bread of life, who gave all of himself for us to make us capable of asking God for whatever we need, to be confident in God's ability to provide it, and to be confident in Christ's ability to heal our afflictions. Now, in this scripture reading this morning, we also discover that Jesus' time among the Gentiles won't stop here at the city of Tyre. In fact, it's only just beginning now with this woman who comes asking for healing and the demonstration of her faith and his ability. And perhaps it is the faith of this unknown Gentile woman that causes Jesus to stay in Gentile land for a while as he travels north next to Sidon and then south down to the Decapolis. Perhaps it was the faith and confidence of this Gentile Syro-Phoenician woman who demonstrated her confidence in him that new possibilities for the spread of the gospel began already. As Jesus heads off now into vast Gentile territory, healing and teaching and proclaiming the good news of God in the world. Jesus is teaching about being the bread of life as a symbol for our Christian faith is extensive in Mark's gospel if we just connect those dots. It starts when he fed the 5,000 with two fish and 5 loaves of bread. It went on then to him teaching about how he was the bread of life come down from heaven that leads to life eternal, and extends now even to this Gentile woman who begs him for crumbs. Because the bread of life in Jesus Christ is truly spiritual food that nourishes our souls. Jesus says the bread of life is this new life today and the eternal life to come. Jesus says the bread of life is shared now with people far and wide from all walks of faith. And the bread of life is available to all who are bold enough and confident enough to claim their faith in Jesus Christ and not be dissuaded. Jesus, the bread of life, is calling us this morning once again to his table of grace. So come, let's join him there this morning in order that our souls might be fed and our persistence strengthened. Beloved in the Lord Jesus Christ, this Holy Supper which we are about to celebrate is a feast of remembrance, of communion, and of hope. We come in remembrance that our Lord Jesus Christ was sent of the Father into the world to assume our flesh and blood and to fulfill for us all obedience to the divine law, even to the bitter and shameful death on the cross. By Christ's death and resurrection and ascension, he established for us a new and eternal covenant of grace, that we might be accepted by God and never forsaken by him. We then come this day to have communion with the same Christ, who has promised to be with us all always, even to the end of the age. In the breaking of the bread, he makes himself known to us as the true heavenly bread, the bread of life that strengthens us to life eternal. And in the cup of blessing, he comes to us as the true vine, whom we must abide if we too are to bear fruit. And we come, my friends, in hope that believing that this bread and this cup are but a pledge and a foretaste of the feast of love of which we too shall partake when we are made like him in his glory and the veil between us is lifted, when we shall behold him with our own eyes in all his glory. Since by his death and resurrection and ascension, Christ obtained for us the life-giving Spirit of God that unites us and exists within us and calls us all into one body of faith, so too are we to receive this supper mindful of the communion of saints. Come, for all things are now ready. The Lord be with you. We lift up our hearts to the Lord.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praises.
Holy and right it is, and our joyful duty to give thanks to you at all times and in all places, O Lord our Creator, almighty and everlasting God. You created the heaven with all its hosts and the earth with all its plenty. You have given us life and being and preserve us by your providence. But you have shown to us the fullness of your love in sending into the world your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, the eternal Word, the bread of life made flesh for us and our salvation. For the precious gift of this mighty Savior, who has reconciled us to you, we worship and adore your glorious name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Most righteous God, we remember in this supper the perfect sacrifice offered once on the cross by our Lord Jesus Christ for the sin of the whole world. In joy of his resurrection and in expectation of his coming again, we offer ourselves to you as holy and living sacrifices. Together we claim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Send your Holy Spirit upon us, we pray, that the bread which we break and the cup which we bless may be to us the communion with the body and blood of Christ. Grant that being joined together with him, we may attain to the unity of the faith and grow up in all things into Christ our Lord. And as this grain has been gathered from many fields into one loaf and these grapes from many hills into one cup, grant, O Lord, that your whole church may soon be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread when he had given thanks to God for it, and he broke it. And he said to his disciples, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me, the body of Christ."
Thank you.
element in my blood, which is shed for you. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. Cup of blessing which we bless is to us the communion with the blood of Christ. We remember your acts of power as well as your deeds of love and compassion, even to a Samaritan woman. May we go forth from this place ever grateful for your gifts, never mindful of the communion of saints far and wide of whom we are counted, past, present, and future. Abide in us, Lord, as your beloved disciples, until we are joined together with you and the Father in the heavenly realms. Go with us, Lord. Keep us ever mindful of your table of grace, where you wait to feed us once again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our responsive hymn is number 346, did I get that right? 346?
Yes.
349. 349, thank you.
No, 346.
What does it say in the bulletin?
346.
Okay. Let's stand and praise God together.
I've got 349, I'm sorry.
Well,
that's
okay.
Yeah. 346, yeah.
I couldn't, there was a glare on the number, I couldn't make it out.
Thank you.
the love of Christ flows forth from within you.
May the Holy Spirit's power at work within us transform us into a people who look, sound, and act like Jesus to a world in need of healing. Go forth and live in peace.